So my name is Dr. Olajide Williams. I work at the Neurological Institute of New York at Columbia University. And my area of specialty is stroke. And my goal is to eradicate pre-hospital delays to acute stroke treatments. The classic public health paradigm is that information filters from parents to children. But when you're dealing with areas and populations that are dominated by hard-to-reach parents, and you just can't reach parents because they're busy struggling with survival and life and trying to put food on the table, when you're dealing with those types of parents, how do you reach them? How do you communicate with them? And so we were forced to reverse that paradigm and ask the question, can we reach them through their kids?
I'm gonna tell you a story right now. Yo, yo, here we go. Once upon a time in a city called Harlem.
Most Americans don't realize that stroke is an eminently treatable disease. That's one of the reasons why only 3 to 5% of Americans are actually treated.
So the Hip Hop Stroke Program is a program that utilizes hip hop music to teach children the signs and symptoms of stroke and the appropriate action in the event of stroke.
As a result of our efforts across Harlem, we actually saw one hospital quadrupling the TPA treatment rate. You can't see. Sometimes kids
see what you can't see. I really think that we do the coolest research on the planet. How many NIH-funded studies involve a hip-hop icon, involves rap music, involves interacting with children around the five pillars of hip-hop culture? So I was born in Lagos, Nigeria. My father was a doctor. He was a physician. He was one of the few physicians of his generation, of his time. Remember, he grew up in colonial Nigeria. Nigeria got its independence in 1960. Fortunately for him, his grandmother was a very successful trader. She traded in lace and fabrics across the West African coast. And so she was able to send him to medical school, you know, shortly after independence. There was a huge need for public health expertise, setting up the infrastructure of healthcare in the country. And so he studied public health here at Johns Hopkins here in America, and then went back to Nigeria and really helped build the infrastructure of the Nigerian health system. My mother actually majored in history, but she ended up being a civil servant. She was an incredible administrator, and she worked at the highest levels of the Nigerian government. I left for London, I think when I was about 9, when I went to boarding school, where the likes of Prime Minister Attlee went, and Chris Nolan was a classmate of mine, actually. I would not want to do it again, but all in all, it was very powerful because I think it defined a lot of who I am today. I always had to figure things out on my own. I always had to depend on myself. I mean, I thought I had challenges in boarding school for all those years, but it was nothing compared to what I was about to experience at medical school in Nigeria. You know, a lot of my colleagues were very poor. I was actually one of the lucky ones because I could eat 3 meals a day. Most of my colleagues had a diet they call 010, which they only ate 1 meal a day. We had very little electricity, no power. Most of the time, our lecture theaters were dilapidated. I've never seen a CT scan until I got to America. I was going from Wonderland into the belly of hell. So I think that enduring those challenges, it made me fall in love with the idea of uplifting those less fortunate than me. And so it really made me realize that perhaps this experience is to prepare me for what I was going to be doing for the rest of my life, which is the service to those less fortunate than me. And so, you know, so the seeds of what I do today, I believe, were planted and fertilized in those early years in Africa. We are constantly researching in our own personal lives. But I think that if you have a problem that you want to make better, the only way to do that properly is to do it through proven mechanisms, proven methods, and the only way to acquire the skill sets to develop those types of proven methods and proven mechanisms is through research, training, and the implementation of that product. And so no matter who you are, no matter where you are, no matter what sector you're in, we just happen to be in the healthcare sector, but research is part and parcel of making things better. And so my advice to anyone who's interested in a career in medicine or in health or in science is to basically understand the basic principle that research is going to be a part and parcel of your life. It's going to be a part and parcel of the questions you ask on your road, on your journey. It's going to be a part and parcel of your inner strive to make things better around you. There's just no escaping research. I feel fulfilled by the direction of our research and by the progress we have made, but I'm not satisfied with where we are. I don't think I'll ever be satisfied, because I think this is work that will go on indefinitely, and we're going to get closer and closer and closer to the answer and to that ideal, but at least I don't see us getting there in my generation. I think if you're passionate about something, if you believe in something, find your research question in that space and run with it. Because if you don't love what you're doing, if you don't love the research you're doing, if it's not meaningful to you, the chances are you won't excel in it and you won't discover the answers to the questions that you're trying to solve. And so I went into a very non-traditional space of research. It's public health, social science, neurology, all mixed in together. And it's not a well-defined career. It's not there's no clear pathway or trajectory within this space. Sometimes it's hard to get into the game. And in those situations, it may be best to create your own game and invite others to join you. And that's kind of how what I feel that we've done here with our hip-hop programs. It's not a traditional area of research that one would expect the NIH to fund, but that tells you a lot about the NIH. It tells you a lot about their openness to solutions, their openness to ideas. As long as you can demonstrate feasibility, and as long as you can demonstrate plausibility, feasibility, and your ability to implement successfully and actually, you know, achieve the aims that you set out to achieve, they will support you. You know, when I first started this, my research, a lot of people didn't even think that there was a research question housed in what I was trying to do. A lot of people didn't think there was science and scientific principles and a career in the question I was trying to answer. But then again, I was passionate about this question. I believed in this question. And I think that's where we should all begin.